Yes, sir.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Moinak and other organizers for inviting me. Although when I got the invitation, I was a bit surprised because I have not done any genetics on corona for the last 1.5 years. In fact, I have not done any genomics at all. But Moinak wanted me to present the sero survey that we have done in the past 1 year. And so I need to warn you that although this is a conference of ISHG, there is no G here. So with that caveat, what I'll try to present to you today, there is a problem, the slides are not moving. I don't know. Sometimes these the
slide. Just click on the slide. Just click on the slide and see if it moves.
Okay. Sometimes it gets stuck. So sorry about that. So I will present today two studies. One is the CSIR Phenome India, which is also called as the CSIR cohort. And the second one is trying to understand vaccine efficiency. And that we collaborated with the Max Hospital Delhi to try and understand the efficiency of the vaccines. So starting with the CSIR cohort, so this is a longitudinal cohort involving CSIR personnel and their family members. And what we are doing is we are trying to do multiple rounds of sero survey in the CSIR population to understand the burden of the disease and to also look at the stability of the antibodies. So the basic questions that we are asking, do you have antibodies against COVID-19? If so, how long will the antibody persist? So let me take you to the perspective of time. We started this study in July of 2020. This was the first sero survey, which went up to September, mid of September. And then we did a second sero survey in the month of February and March. And currently we are in the third sero survey. We have just completed the sero survey, and I'll show you some of the data from here. Now, when we compare that with the national sero survey of ICMR, these were the timelines of ICMR sero survey. And the difference between ICMR sero survey and CSIR sero survey was ICMR did not do a longitudinal study. So although they that study could tell us the sero positivity in the population, there was no data on the stability of the antibodies. And also ICMR randomly picked up districts, and the districts that picked up by ICMR, other than two, they are not common with CSIR. So we majorly concentrated for CSIR labs, which are in various cities. And ICMR was more focused on rural and semi-urban areas. So basically, we were trying to, as I told you, estimate the burden of SARS-CoV-2 infection post the second wave, estimate the reinfection, understand vaccine efficiency. So to just take you back, this was the data from the first sero survey that was done primarily in August, September, although some labs gave in June, July also. And there we found that there were varied sero positivities across the country. So box that is shown in green, we had a seropositivity of greater than 10%, whereas all boxes shown in blue, there was a seropositivity of 5 to 10%, and red are those which had less than 5% seropositivity. And the overall seropositivity that we got was about 10.14%. And there were four important conclusions from our study. One was we followed the seropositivity, we classified them based on the cities based on population density. So anywhere which had a population density of less than 1,000, we termed it as low density population. Anywhere the population was 1,000 to 10,000, they were medium density, and high density are like the metros, like Delhi, Hyderabad, Bangalore, where the density of the population is more than 10,000 person per square kilometer. And as you can see here, during the first sero survey, that is primarily during August and September, low density areas had low seropositivity, which increased, while high density areas at that time itself had reached almost 14 to 15% seropositivity. The second thing, and this was one of the most important things that we found, was almost 75% of the subjects were asymptomatic, which means that these people never went for any RT-PCR test, but they were infected, although they had asymptomatic infection, but they could be carriers, which could not be identified through RT-PCR. So this was one of the reasons why sero surveys are done. So 75% of the subjects at that time we found to be asymptomatic. The third observation was people who traveled in public transport and outsourced staff. Outsourced staff, we mean that people in the security, housekeeping, gardeners who are more exposed, they had much higher seropositivity. For example, outsourced staff had a seropositivity of 16.22 in comparison to 7.98 for regular staff. And it was very highly significant. The odds ratio was more than 2. Similarly, for people who traveled by their own car or walked to the campus, the seropositivity was about 9.3%, while people who use public transport, the seropositivity was more than 15%, and this also had an odds ratio of 1.79. The third and the most important thing that we found was we followed these people who were seropositive in the month of August, September for every 3 months. So what we found was, so if you look at this graph, the x-axis is the seropositivity at baseline, antibody levels at the baseline. Y-axis is antibody levels at 3 months, and here it is antibody levels after 6 months. So you can see that in most of the cases, the antibody levels increased at 3 months, but the neutralizing antibody levels started decreasing. And by 6 months, almost 20 to 30% people actually lost their neutralizing antibodies, which means that once you're infected, even after 6 months, you might have the antibodies, but the neutralizing ability of that antibody is lost. Now, coming to the second and third sero survey, as I told you, we did it, the second sero survey in February, March, and the third sero survey was after the pandemic. It started in June and it went up to August. So you can see we have data just before the peak and just after the peak. But the problem with the third sero survey was India started its vaccination program in January 2021. And most of the CSIR staff started getting vaccinated from April. So second sero survey, we did not have the problem. But the third sero survey, we had a problem that people also are vaccinated. So how to check whether they are seropositive or not? So if you look at the vaccine, there are two kinds of vaccines that were given. One was Covishield, AstraZeneca. The other is Covaxin. So Covishield is the targets against the spike glycoprotein. So anybody who is vaccinated with Covishield will have antibodies against spike, but will not have antibodies against any other proteins. Whereas people who have taken your inactivated virus vaccine, that is Covaxin, will have antibodies against all of them. So assessing the infection in people who have taken Covaxin is difficult, and we are trying to find a way to do it. I'll not present the data today, but what I'll show you is what is the status with Covishield, because there we measured both nucleocapsid, the antibodies against nucleocapsid protein and antibodies against spike protein. So anybody having antibodies against nucleocapsid protein were actually infected. So with that logic, we looked at the data that we got. We had more than 12,000 samples in the third phase, of which, as you can see, 68% were vaccinated at that time, either with one dose or two dose. And this is significantly higher than the general Indian numbers. And that is expected because these people, you know, are more aware and have taken more vaccine. So we had about 32% people who were not vaccinated and 68% people who were vaccinated. And of the vaccinated people who had taken Covishield, 75% of them had taken one dose and 25% of them had taken two doses. While people who had taken Covaxin, about 56% had taken two doses and 44% had taken one dose. What was interesting is about 20% of the total population, total vaccinated population had taken Covaxin. So I'll not show you the data of that 20% today. So if you now look at the data, so this was phase one. The seropositivity was 10%. In February, March, the seropositivity increased to 28%. But the current seropositivity, and this is unvaccinated individuals. So these are 3,975 unvaccinated individuals across the country. The average seropositivity is 72%. In the third phase, we also got ethical permission to take from people, from children more than 5 years old. So we had 435 such samples, and the seropositivity there was also roughly 57%. Now, if you look at what happens if you take vaccine, so the total seropositivity in unvaccinated is 72. If we look only at people who had taken one or two doses of Covishield, the seropositivity in them was 48%. Mind it, this 48% means, so probably 100% of them have antibodies, but only 48% had antibodies against the nucleocapsid protein, which means that 48% were infected. And if we add the two up, the average seropositivity in the country is 57%. And what is very interesting, we are doing the analysis now, but if you look at it at a glance, you will see that most of the northern region, the seropositivity was very high, and southern region, the seropositivity was not that high. And that probably is one of the reasons that Kerala, Andhra, and Bangalore are seeing much more cases now, compared to Delhi, where we are only having about 30 to 40 cases a day. Now, if you look at the kinetics of the seropositivity in between August 2020 and February 2021, there was an increase in seropositivity. But if you look at the slope, the seropositivity from February to February 21 to July 2021, the slope was significantly higher. Just to take, so while we are currently doing the analysis, I'll take you to some of the analysis that we have already done for Delhi. So the seropositivity in Delhi in first phase was 14%, and these samples were collected in June 2020. In the second phase, samples collected in February, it was 42%. So from, which means that from June to February, it took there was an increase of around 30% of seropositivity. But look at it from February to May June again. So next 4 months, we have a huge increase in seropositivity. And this, and if you think about this number, 88% of the unvaccinated people in Delhi are already infected. And most interestingly, I showed you data that in the first phase, we saw that people who use public transport and outsourced stuff had higher seropositivity than people who use private transport and regular staff and students in the CSIR. That difference actually increased in February, but look at what has happened in June, July. There is absolutely no difference. So during this 2 to 3 months from February to April, almost everybody had got infected. Now, why did this happen? I told you Delhi had a seropositivity of 42%. Yet, why so many people in Delhi got affected? One of the reasons I told you 20% of them lost neutralizing capacity in 6 months. The second reason is, what is important is, although they were seropositive, we then analyzed the quantitative antibody levels of phase one and phase two. And you can see that the quantitative antibody levels at phase two, the median value was 2.01 log, which translates to 102.3 units per ml. But if you look at it, for this particular kit, WHO has mandated 132 units per ml to be cleared for convalescent plasma, which means that if you have an antibody level of more than 132, you are safe from this particular strain. Right? And also now, if you look at the neutralizing antibody levels, if you look at this quadrant, so this is the horizontal blue line indicates 30% of neutralizing capacity, and the perpendicular line again indicates the 132 level that I was talking about. Only very few percentage of people they actually had that kind of antibody and neutralizing antibody levels. So it is not surprising that we got a lot of infections. So were there reinfections? To look at that, we employed a strategy, and we could do this because, as I told you, we collected samples at different time points. And when we look at the nucleocapsid antibody, the idea was, if the nucleocapsid antibody fell from phase one to phase two, and then if it suddenly rises, which means that the person has been reinfected. And you can see the reinfection rate that we got was 27.5%. In contrast, for people who are actually not reinfected, you can see this kind of a graph where the antibody levels rise and then fall, or are stable and then fall. So if we consider there are four such samples where this classic definition did not hold, but the slope changed drastically. So if we consider those also to be reinfected, then the reinfection rate is more than 30%. With that, I'll just come to the next part of this story, that is the vaccine efficiency. So I just want you to remember that 27% people were reinfected from the first part. And just to talk about the structure of the cohort, we had about 597 samples that we started with, and we divided the samples as seronegative cases and seropositive. That means that people at day zero, the day that they were vaccinated, they were actually did not have any antibodies. So they are seronegative at baseline. And about 309 samples were there who actually were infected even before taking the vaccine, which means that they were called the SP group or the seropositive group. And this is the timeline of our sample collection. We started in January with when the healthcare started getting vaccinated. And by February end and March middle, most of the people had got second dose. This is our 45th day collection where the cases were not there. And when we've looked at these people at 90 days, this is the time which coincided with the pandemic in Delhi. You can look at the blue line, which confirms the COVID confirmed cases. So right in the middle of that, we did the 90-day sample collection. So that gave us a handle to look at how many people were negative at 45 days but turned positive in 90 days. So just to go back, what was the antibody response? For people who did not have antibodies at baseline, that is seronegative, the antibody levels started increasing. This is here, they got the second dose. It increased further and then it started to plateau. On the other hand, people who were already having infection, their antibody levels rose tremendously within 7 days. So you can see, so from about 100 median, their antibody levels rose to a median of almost 6,000 units per ml within 7 days. But then what happens is, even after taking the second dose, there is no change in the median level, and the antibody levels actually start falling at day 90. We then looked at, using the same principle as above, people who had no antibodies against nucleocapsid antibody at day 45 versus day 90, we found that 25.3% people actually had a breakthrough. So even though they took the vaccine, and these are all seronegative people, so if they had taken, they were negative, they had taken two doses of vaccine at least 15 days before they got the infection. So we could do because we had 45-day samples also and 90-day samples also. We looked at the people who got breakthrough infection, the antibody levels and neutralizing antibody levels, they were not at all different. So you, with this level of antibody, there is no guarantee that you are going to be protected. We then asked, were they infected by Delta? Because we did not do sequencing of these. We wanted to confirm it by a different means. So what we did was, with the help of THSTI, Shankar and THSTI, what we did was we did microneutralization test. Here you can see, this is a little bit complicated graph. So you can see each circle represents all the 23 people who got breakthrough infection. The top half is the neutralization against wild type, the bottom half is the neutralization against Delta. So at 45 day, most of the people had good neutralizing capability against wild type, but did not have neutralizing capacity against Delta. What happened in 90 days? All of them now have huge antibody neutralizing capacity against both wild type and Delta, which clearly shows that these people were infected with Delta. We also looked at neutralizing ability of Delta and wild type. So if you go for the same neutralizing ability, for example, 1:80 dilution, you can see that you need much lower antibody levels to neutralize against wild type. Rather, you need much higher levels to neutralize against Delta. So if you look at this, if you talk about 1:80 neutralization, which is considered to be very good, you need an antibody level of more than 1500 units per ml to get that done. Unfortunately, this level of antibody is not reached by two vaccines, nor is reached by one infection. So we looked at the seropositive individuals, people who were having infection earlier and then were vaccinated. Even if people who were having infection and were vaccinated with one dose, their levels of antibodies were much higher than 1500, and the vaccine breakthrough rate in these people were about 3% only. Which means that, so from this study, we are trying to propose a cutoff of more than 1500 for this kind of a vaccine, which is Covishield, to render some sort of protection against any variant. Now, the same thing, if we summarize here, if you take only one dose of vaccine, your antibody levels are around 50. Neutralizing antibodies are 31% is the median. If you take two doses, your antibody levels increases from 1.65 to 2.66, that is 44.6 units per ml, to about 457. If you are infected naturally after 45 to 90 days, your antibodies levels reach about 240 units per ml. But if you are infected and then you have taken a single dose of vaccine, your antibody levels are more than 6,000 units per ml. So it is really not required for these people to take the second dose immediately. So this can be delayed. So this has lots of policy, policy decisions can be based on sero surveys. And just to summarize, from the two studies, what we found that in Delhi, in case of unvaccinated people, this is from the CSIR cohort, we found 87% infection. Vaccinated with one dose, we had about 48% infection, which means that if a person has taken, was previously uninfected and taken only one dose, the chances of him getting infected is about 48%. Vaccinated with two doses, this we just, I showed you from the max cohort, is about 25.3% breakthrough. And reinfection, I told you, it's about 27%. And most importantly, person who was previously infected and then vaccinated, the rate is only about 2.5%. So the question to be addressed, and this is a $1 million question now being asked, do previously uninfected people need a booster shot of the vaccine? So that time will tell, more studies are required for that. But this is what we have done in the last 1 year. And so I would like to thank the Max team, and also I would like to thank the THSTI team for the microneutralization assay. There is some problem going on. Is my screen visible? I also like to thank all the coordinators of the CSIR lab for their effort. It was really a tremendous effort during COVID times. They did not hesitate. They came forward and collected samples. And it was a tremendous teamwork, and I'm really grateful to them. Finally, I'd like to thank all IGIB CSIR cohort staff and students. They worked tirelessly 24 hours a day. They did not take a break. What we used to tell is our analyzer, where we analyze the antibody levels, never got a rest. And finally, thank you all.